Tonight on Access TV, it's Gotham Comedy Live. Get ready to laugh with Jeff Maurer, Erin Jackson, Brian Scolaro, Roderick Paulette. This week's host, Tommy Chong. Gotham Comedy Live, all happening right now. Ladies and gentlemen, Tommy Chong!
Hey! Welcome to Gotham Comedy Live. I'm Tommy Chong, and I'm a dancer. Everybody wanted to know, what made you do that? What made me go on Dancing with the Stars? It was a woman. My wife. She submitted my name 2 years ago. I didn't know about it. And then they called me in for an audition, you know. An audition is if I'm still alive, you know. Because the whole point of the show is to get old guys, old fuckers like me, you know. And then make them try to do impossible physical things for a minute with a beautiful girl. And then everybody can, oh, look at him, you know, stumbling around. But I fooled him a little bit because I had a little dancing experience, you know. I used to be a black guy. Oh, I was a black guy for years. Like, I got so black I even married a white woman. That's how... I was with Motown, man. I was with Motown. In fact, when I got out of Motown, I was even up for a black movie. They're going to do a remake of Driving Miss Daisy. The black version was called Get in the Car, Bitch. But instead, I went into the comedy field after Motown because I was actually, you know, being a... I wasn't a black guy, you know, obviously. I was the closest thing to a white guy in a black band. And so that I was like the token white guy. I was the guy that was sent in to get the lunches and shit like that. But it was, but anyway, I that's how I got into dancing. You know, you hang out with black people, you end up dancing, you know. Yeah, they dance all the time, man. I was in jail, man. Fuckers, we're dancing there too, man. It's so cool too, you know, everything was so cool. So I had to learn, you know, I mean, my first wife was black and so I definitely had to learn how to dance. And I did. And so, you know, then when Dancing with the Stars come up, I was kind of ready for it, you know. It was a lot of hard work. It was fucking hard work, man. Dancing wasn't hard. It was remembering this shit. Because when you dance at a club, man, all you do, you know, you get drunk, you get out there, and you just make up your own dances, you know? All of a sudden, I had to put my hand a certain way, I had to stand a certain way, oh, fuck this, you know? But I did it. And the other thing I did, I quit smoking pot to make a point. Because I didn't want anybody to say, you know, oh, he fucked up because he was high on pot. Because I would have fucked up if I was high on pot. You know, when you're high and pot, you hear music like that. You don't want to move anywhere. You just want to drop it like it's hot. Drop it like it's hot. But I did it, man. So I went without pot for the whole whatever how long I was on the show. And so when they say, oh, you know, and the couple going home tonight, and they do that big, you know, Tommy and Peter. Everybody, a lot of people were sad. I was thinking, fuck, I'm going to get high tonight, man. And let me tell you, if you want an experience, you know, like I've been smoking pot for, what, 50 years, you know. If you want an experience, quit smoking for a while. Quit. And then when you feel like doing it, don't do it. And then when you do it, oh my God. Only thing, I wish I had a woman in the room. That was the only thing. That would have been perfect, you know. As it was kind of perfect, you know. was, you know, I got to know myself pretty well. You know? I know where to touch, you know. But pot, man. In New York, oh, big thing in New York. Oh, they're you're gonna get a ticket for a bag of pot. Oh, a ticket. Wow. Is that progress, huh? Oh boy, and they're really proud of it. The mayor's holding a bag of pot. The pot. I'm holding a bag of pot. Everybody get that? How fucking lame is this guy, man? Or the it was the police. I can't tell the part. The chief of police or the mayor, one of them. They're lame fuckers, man. I'm sorry. To be the mayor of the biggest city in the world, you can have the pot, but you can't smoke it. That's another law. That makes sense. Yeah. Okay. Law-abiding New Yorkers will really take care of that law. Yeah. Well, I got pot, but I can't smoke it. Okay, I'll just show it to everybody. In New York, you know, people are, you know, when they legalized it in Colorado, you know, they had a whole thing, all the straight people going, now how are we going to distribute this stuff, you know? Now, we've had that taken care of for years, dude. In New York City alone, you could get pot faster than you can get a pizza. Because I know, I ordered both, man. And the pot was always there first, man. Some guy on a bicycle, you never saw his face, just saw the bag. You give him the money, man, it's happening, you know. No, the pot thing, man. See, the only thing, you know, if everybody was stoned, there'd be less violence in the world, man, you know. Because they've done studies and they found that you can't hurt anybody if you can't find your car keys, you know. When you get stoned on pot, man, you walk around the house all day with the keys in one hand, you know. And they talk about pot being a gateway drug. It's more of a doorway drug. As soon as you walk through that doorway, you can't remember what the fuck you're looking for. What am I doing in the closet? Why am I holding my keys? That's why I keep a bong in every room of my house. And then you go, oh, a bong. Okay, I know what to do now. And driving. Everybody's worried about driving when you're stoned. No. You're not going to hurt anybody going 5 miles an hour. No. But you do get paranoid at the wrong time. You know, like one time I got pulled over by a caution light. I sat there for a long time, man. I had my license up, waiting. Finally, I forgot why I was sitting there, you know. As well, as long as I'm here, might as well, fire went up. I'm smoking. Sure enough, as soon as you light a joint, here comes the cops. Cops, I thought I was watching television, man. Well, good, cops is on. Oh. Bad boys, bad boys. So the cop's looking at me, and I'm staring at him, you know, and they don't like to be stared at. So the cop goes, hey, what are you stopping here for? And I said, didn't you pull me over? That cop looked at me for a long time, dude. Then he goes, did I? But the other worry is kids, you know. They're always worried about kids. And the other day I was on my roof smoking, because I like to smoke up, you know. I even though it's legal, I still like to sneak around, you know. It adds to the high, you know. And I was up there smoking, and I felt somebody looking at me. And I looked down, there's my little grandson looking at me. And he goes, what are you doing, Grandpa? That cute little voice. And I don't know why I said it, but I said, fuck off. I felt bad because, you know, he's the only one in the house that'll show me how to use my iPhone. Okay, we're going to start. We're going to wrap it up. That's what we're going to do. So thank you very much.
Stay tuned for more laughs on Access TV, live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City. Jeff Maurer is taking the stage when we return.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage a writer for the John Oliver Show on HBO, Jeff Maurer. Come on up here, Jeff.
Hi. Hello. Hello. Thank you for coming. Hope you're doing well. A little about myself. Before I was a comedian, I was a speech writer. A quick writing tip for aspiring writers in the crowd. If you want to be a better writer, listen to old school rap. It's a real thing. Old school rappers are the best writers because they get straight to the point. Sir Mix-a-Lot, Baby Got Back. What's the first line in that song? I like big butts. Boom, topic sentence. Right away we know his thesis, then he elaborates. How do you like them? Round and big. When do you like them? When I'm doing a gig. Do you have a supporting quote? Yes, I have one from my anaconda, as a matter of fact. I was a speechwriter for a guy who is a bit of an idiot. He always used to say, boy, that guy really screwed the pooch. Which always made me think, how did the phrase screwed the pooch become the only straight-up bestiality reference we casually toss around? And how did it happen the first time? Some guy in a meeting, boy, he screwed up. You know, like when you have sex with a dog and people are like, whew, I have been to that shrine. Oops. There's no other phrase like that. No one walks in a meeting, boy, he really finger-banged that gorilla. Like, what? He finger-banged the gorilla. He was late. That's all that means. Come on. My boss was an idiot. He didn't know how to use Google. How do you not know how to use Google? Google is idiot-proof. If your search is in the neighborhood, Google will find it. I will search the dumbest things. I'm just like, mullet, booty, shorts, basketball. Google's like, Larry Bird? I'm like, yep, bingo, that was it. Yeah. I can't spell Bosnia-Herzegovina. That was it. I was drowning. Thank you, Google. That was good. I'm almost worried Google is going to get too far in my brain. I'm worried one day I'm going to search, like, football highlights. Google's going to go, did you mean Broadway show tunes? Like, yes, I did. Yes. Maybe I search law school application. Did you mean comedy's not working out? Like, whoo! Got a little too close to the bone there, Google. I love Google. I hate Skype, though. I hate Skype. I mean, it's amazing. Skype is a video phone. We always thought in the future we'd have video phones. Now we have them. Turns out it's a shitty invention because I don't want to get dressed up for a fucking phone call. My friends are like, let's Skype. I'm like, great, now I gotta take off my Snuggie and rejoin society. Gotta clean 3 square feet of my apartment and point the camera at it. Skype is also way too aggressive with the updates because it asks you 3 times if you want an update, and if you say no, it just does it anyway. You're like, Skype, I don't think I'm ready. It's like, shut your browser, this is happening! You don't know you want it, but you do. You're going to love this. It violates you with an update that gives you a million viruses. Next time I open my browser, all of a sudden I have the Ask Jeeves toolbar. My homepage is suddenly ISIS.net. I'm signed up for the racist Obama joke of the day. And of course I have Norton antivirus, the antivirus software 10 times more annoying than any virus you could ever get. Norton antivirus is a pop-up that crashes your computer. That's Norton antivirus, like curing a fever with Ebola since 1995. Norton. So I'm a comedian now though, I'm on the road a lot. When I'm on the road, I like to eat at chain restaurants. Give me a Bennigan's, a TGI Fridays, like any place with a toboggan on the wall for no real reason. That's where I like to go. Because it gives me a chance to play my favorite game, which is a game I call Chain Restaurant Appetizer or Urban Legend Sex Act. It's a great game. Here's how you play. One person takes a menu, and they call the name of an item that could be the name of an appetizer from the menu, or it could be the name of a horribly graphic Urban Legend Sex Act. For example, Irish Haystack. And you have to remember, wait, is that the one with, like, the onions and the ranch dressing? Or is that the one where you fuck a dwarf on a big pile of corned beef? Yeah, it's a thinking man's game. It's a little different at every restaurant. At Outback, it'll be Bloomin' Onion, Cleveland Steamer, that type of thing. So I thought it might be fun to play a little practice round very quickly. These are all...
Yeah! Yeah!
Pre-applause, I like it! Here we go. These are all real appetizers and fake Urban Legend sex acts. You know, feel free to play along. Appetizer or sex act? Vietnamese summer. Appetizer, although that was said with such confidence, I think it might also be a sex act. Manhattan hot platter. That is a sex act. Very good. There's no challenge at all on that one. They knew it right away. Mexican hot fingers. Appetizer. New York style taco. That's tricky. Involves guacamole, but is in fact a sex act. Well played. Let's get through these quickly. Four-way sampler. Appetizer. Chili dog. Both. One's gotta be both, right? Gotta throw a curveball in there somewhere. Brownie bottom pie. Brownie. Bottom pie. That is an appetizer. That's a real thing. You can eat that. You can. Here's the last one. Mexican hot finger. Sex act, because it's one, because it's only one finger this time. One at Applebee's. When at Applebee's, make sure you order the hot fingers, or you will not like what the waiter does. Or you will really like it. I don't know what you're into. Have fun. To each his own. I am on the road a lot. Let me say this. Fuck Delaware. I am so sick of driving through Delaware. If you want to go anywhere south of New York, you have to go through Delaware. And you don't go through the middle. You just go through this little nub, just this bump, just Delaware's ass sticking out and giving Pennsylvania a lap dance. That's all it is. And for a 10-minute drive through Delaware, they charge you $12 in tolls. Delaware's highways cost more per mile than the fanciest hooker in Delaware. Some trips are a lot more fun. I got to go to Europe. That was a blast. I was in Europe just long enough to realize, wow, I don't know a damn thing about the metric system. I don't. Like, the only metric conversion I know is 4 grams equals a stash. 50 kilos is one shipment. Stuff that I learned from Scarface. It's the one time in my life I wished I had done a lot of drugs, because stoners have the metric system down cold, right? They have to. After the show, go to St. Mark's, try to buy half a cup of weed. You can't. You're going to sound like an Amish narc trying to buy half a cup. I'm Jeff Maurer. Thanks a lot. Enjoy the rest of the show. Have a good night. Thank you.
Stay tuned for more laughs on Access TV. Live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City, Erin Jackson is taking the stage when we return. Welcome back to the Access TV presentation of Gotham Comedy Live. More laughs happening right now.
Welcome to the stage, Erin Jackson. Erin Jackson, last comic standing.
Hey, what's going on, New York? Yes. I just moved here. For the past 2 years, I live with my retired parents in Virginia. Yeah, yeah. Because I'm fantastic at comedy. That's why that happened. Career's going great. You may or may not know this about old black people. I learned this living with my folks. They hate electricity. Yeah, sometimes my dad would just walk into a room and he would decide the lights had been on too long. It didn't matter what you were doing in the room. He would just walk in, look around, and be like, no, I think that's enough. And that'd just be it. You'd be done. My parents' new favorite pastime is to walk me around their home and then point out all the things that are going to be mine when they pass away. Which is weird, because I'm an only child, and I had assumed everything they had was going to be mine when they passed away. I'm like, who gets that? Not everything was on the tour. Last time I was there, my mom had a new lamp in the living room, and I said, Mom, that's a really pretty lamp. Where'd you get it? She's like, don't worry about where I got it, because we have another one now just like it upstairs in the bedroom. So if something ever happens to me or your dad, you'll have a matching set. And I was like, wow, thanks, Mom. That's an awesome way for me to get two new lamps. Or you could just tell them where you bought it like I asked you. And you and Daddy could live. How about that? They're weird. They've already picked out the photograph they want on their funeral programs. It's a real thing. They took a portrait for their church photo directory. They really liked it. So when they got it back, they gave it to me. They said, Erin, this is the one. This is the one we want to use. And I was like, okay, first of all, morbid. Second of all, this is a picture of both of you. What the hell are you planning? Why are y'all gonna be on the same program? I might get my lamp sooner than later. Right, then my mom, she lost a few pounds, right? And then she gave me a new picture of herself that she liked better. And she's like, Erin, I wanna use this one instead. I was like, oh, so you changed your mind about the suicide packs? Yeah? Gonna leave my daddy hanging like that? My mom is texting now. Your folks texting? Yeah. It's painful, right? Yeah. My mom has made it clear she has no business texting. No business, because I sent her a text message, and then she called me back that same afternoon, because that is how she replies to text messages. She calls me back on the phone. And she said, hey, Erin, in the message you sent me earlier, what does BTW stand for? So I told her it stands for by the way, and then she said, oh, yeah. I guess that makes more sense. And I was like, more sense? Well, what did you think it stood for? And she said Booker T. Washington. That was her guess. In 2014, just screw context. Just, yeah. Why not prominent Negro thought leaders? That's appropriate. Sure, that's what she meant. Booker T. Washington, what time are we meeting for dinner? That's what my mom thought I sent her. And a text message. She told me she went to upgrade her phone, went to the Verizon store, walked in with her flip phone she's had for 3 years, walked out with a Galaxy S5. Booker T. Washington has a Galaxy S5. You see the problem here, right? It's malpractice, whoever sold her that phone, right? She called me, she said, Erin, I need you to teach me how to make a selfie. This is a phone call, how to make a selfie. So I took a deep breath, as I do when I have to help my mom with technology. And I said, okay, Mama, open up the camera on your phone. And I told her which button to push to turn the camera around. She was like, I turn around. I was like, no, you stay where you are. Just push that button and the camera will turn around. And she was like, okay, I pushed it. Now what? I said, do you see yourself on the screen? And she said, I don't know. And I didn't know what to do with that. I don't know. Like the lady that's in all your mirrors, is she on your phone right now? That's you. Yeah. Couples, you guys, couples like that? Couple? Yeah? You married or dating? What's going on?
Dating.
Yeah. I guess that's cute. Yeah. I'm a love hater. Yeah. I hate love. Like, do you hold hands when you go out? You hold hands? Oh my God, I hate that. That's my least favorite form of affection. Like when I see people holding hands on the street, I want it over, I want it to end. Like, I just want to walk right in between. You guys remember that game Red Rover we used to play when we were kids? If you were holding hands, I would send myself over in between. In between your love, because I hate your love. Because I stink at love, yeah. I went to the doctor and he was like, Ms. Jackson, can you tell me what form of birth control you're currently using? And I was like, sure, doc. Right now I am using the no penis method. It is not much fun, but I read in a book last weekend that it's only failed once, so. Some of you read that book? It's a good book. I don't know, I tried online dating. I don't know how you're supposed to find anybody online because it's so segmented. There's so many sites. Like, maybe if everybody was on one site, maybe it'd be easier. But you know what I mean? There's a site for everything. There's a site, you know, just for Jewish people, and a site just for Christian people, and a site just for black people. Like, I don't know if there's a site just for white people, but if there is, it's racist. And don't go on there unless you're racist. Just some advice. There is actually a site. Now, I'm making this up. There's a site for people who are gluten-free. A dating site called glutenfreesingles.com. That's a real thing. Like, which in my mind was not started by a guy with a gluten allergy looking for a woman like him. It was just this dude who was like, look, I'm sick of these chicks coming by my house, eating up all my bread. I gotta start a site so I can find some chicks who don't want to eat up my bread. I joined one of those sites, paid $120 to join, met the worst human being I've ever met in my entire life. It's like, I'm pretty sure I could have met this dude outside a liquor store for free. I didn't need to put it on my MasterCard. You know? Long story short, we went out to dinner, nothing in common. Check came, he ignored it. I paid for my meal. He asked me to then pay for his because, quote, I don't want to break this last 20. You know how it is, boo. Once you break it, it's gone. That happened. And then, oh, that's not the worst part. Then as we were leaving the restaurant, walking back to the car, he stopped and peed in an alley in front of me. And it's crazy, like, the part of me that was a girl on an awful date was like, just jump in the first cab you see and get out of here, right? But the professional comedian part of me was like, see if you can ride it out. You know, like, I did it for y'all, is what I'm saying. And I'm glad I did, because it got better. When he was done zipping up, he came to where I was standing frozen in shock, and he drops this gem. He says, you need to let me walk on the street side of the sidewalk so I can protect you in case a car jumps the curb. Because my mama raised me to be a gentleman. And I was like, that's awesome, Sir PP. Why don't you lay down your jacket so I don't have to step in your piss puddle? That'd be chivalrous. I suck at love. Yeah, my best friend is a little boy. He's 3. He's very worried about my love life. That's how you know it's bad. I'm watching him, babysitting him. He's saying his prayers before bed. Dear God, bless my auntie Ronnie, my uncle Charles, bless my auntie Mimi, and my uncle Eric. And then he's like, mid-prayer, he's like, Auntie Erin, where's your uncle? And like, he's 3, so I know it's an innocent question, but I'm not gonna lie, like, I still felt like he was judging me a little bit. Right. I'd be like, shut up, baby. You don't know what it's like in these streets, you know? I didn't say that, though. What I said was, honey, Auntie Erin lives alone right now because she hasn't found her uncle yet. And he's like, oh, but Auntie Erin, I don't want you to live alone. Do you have toys at your house to play with? And I said, absolutely. I do. Hey, you guys, thank you so much. I've been Erin Jackson.
Stay tuned for more laughs on Access TV, live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City. Brian Scolaro is taking the stage when we return.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome Brian Scalia. Comedy what? Comedy Central. Come on up here.
That was great. Hey, that was when you have millions of dollars, you don't give a shit about Comedy Central. That's how it works. All right. Tommy Chong, everybody. All right, fine. Let me close this up. Give me a second. I'm out of breath. I just walked 10 feet, you know? A couple of stairs right there. That's the fat guy's natural enemy. Stairs, salads, bending over. I almost threw up. Did you see that? That would have really been a bad beginning. Thank God. Because I would have had to keep talking after I puked. Would have been weird. All right, let's calm down. Yeah, I'm a little fat, I know. I'm not sure why you guys brought it up, but I don't think it's that bad being fat, but when you watch TV, everything now is about making fun of fat people. They want you to be ashamed. If it's a commercial and there's a fat guy in the commercial, he bought the wrong thing. Did you ever notice that? The fat guy has the broken car, like, why doesn't my fucking car work? Oh, that's right, I'm fat, I forgot all about it. I must have been thinking about pizza when I bought this fucking car. I'm so fucking fat. There's no fat rights leader, you know? There's nobody to defend us. There's no Martin Luther Burger King Jr. to fucking come out and take a fight on my behalf. It's not bad being fat. It's not bad being fat. There's a lot of good things. You save money on heat. doesn't hurt as much when you're falling down the fucking stairs. Although it is funnier for some fucking reason. You see a fat guy fall downstairs, you remember that your whole life. Remember that fat guy fell down the stairs? 1987. There were sandwiches coming out of his fucking pockets. There was like a potato chip crunch noise on every step. Fucking When you're fat, you can eat whatever you like. You got a whole drawer full of ketchup at the bottom of the fridge. You got a place to put your cake when you watch TV. You don't gotta make your bed because nobody's ever gonna see it. So, time saver right there. That's not true. That's not true. I do okay. I don't do great. I do okay. I do good for my weight class, you know? I did a TV show. Nobody saw it. But they kept saying my character didn't get laid because of his weight. That was what was written into the script. Isn't that fucked up to tell America that fat people don't get laid? Look around. We're everywhere. Somebody's fucking us, you know? And clearly we're breeding as a fucking people. And it's not all fat on fat fucking. We're not creating a master fat race. It's mostly regular shaped people fucking fat shaped people. You know? Some girls fuck fat guys. Not all girls. Not most girls. But some girls fuck fat guys. And ladies, I don't know if you know this. If you fuck a fat guy, you go to heaven. Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's in the Bible. Yeah. That's in the Bible. It's in the Bible. Anyway, the last girl... This is personal. I don't know why you guys asked. But the last girl I was with never fucked a fat guy before. I was the first fat guy that she ever fucked. She didn't tell me that, because that'd be rude. It was just obvious. Like, we're fucking... She was like, why are we taking so many breaks? There's going to be a few breaks, okay? Can you do my favor? Can you put the ceiling fan on, please? Thank you. That gives me 10 extra minutes. When I fuck, I like a glass of water right next to the bed. Maybe a banana for some cramps. Yeah. I always wanted a boxing crew to come in with a bucket and a sponge. And they're like, all right, take it easy out there. Get on the bottom. Stay down. Stay down. She's fucking killing you out there. Anyway. She's going to heaven. I don't know. As a comic, you're like, all right, what are you talking about? You talk about yourself, and then you're like, you want to help people. So I have ideas. I know how to stop getting beat up. Like, if you're ever walking down the street and a bunch of guys jump out of a bush and start beating the shit out of you, just start jerking off. They'll stop. Like, whoa, he likes it. He likes it. Stop. Ha! Oh, let's get out of here. Go, go. You know, it's a great defense we're not using. Nobody wants to touch a guy jerking off. Not even the wife wants to touch the husband jerking off. You could rob a bank like everybody on the floor. Get on the floor. Put the money in the sack. Not that sack. That was right up there, too. Ah, hey, look at me. Look at me. Anyway. Yeah. Other ideas. I have an idea for a car alarm. My car got stolen, and it had a car alarm, and nobody gave a shit. So I was thinking, the car alarm, if it was a voice, it'd be less annoying, and people would care more, and they would look, you know? Like hey, guys. It's the red Honda. Listen, somebody's fucking stealing me. I think it could be windy. I don't know. Maybe a motorcycle went by right next to us. Could you look? I'm sorry. Thank you. Or a woman's voice would be great. Just a woman's voice going, oh, my shirt fell off. Oh, my shirt fell off. My shirt fell off. My shirt fell off. Oh, my shirt fell off. Boobies, boobies. Tits, 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 tits. Hey. Oh. Yay! Oh. Thanks. That joke takes a lot out of me. All right. Now what the fuck do we talk about? Do you think somewhere in the world there's a Chinese guy who's really ticklish and his name is Gitchy Goo? Did you know that the theme song to the movie Jaws was written by a black woman?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. I was very proud of myself. Right. How come whenever you go see a dentist, there's always a big tooth out front? And you go see a foot doctor, there's a big foot. Or an eye doctor, there's a big eye. How come when you see a gynecologist, there's no big pussy outside? You don't gotta lift the flap and ring the doorbell. And the husband can't find it. The wife's like, it's right there. I'll do it myself. Here. Don't press it hard. Here. All right. A lot of these are marijuana jokes. Old MacDonald had a farm. Doesn't that song sound like it was written by a guy in a farm just going fucking nuts? He's like, there's a fucking quack quack here. There's a fucking quack quack there. Everywhere's a fucking quack quack. Sorry. Let's talk about something intelligent. Did you ever have a noise come out of your body that you never heard before? It always happens somewhere quiet, like a bank. You're kind of standing on the line, and you know what your stomach sounds like, and you know what your ass sounds like, but sometimes this area is like, what the fuck was that? Did you hear that? Maybe that chicken sandwich wasn't dead. I heard something come out of me over here, like a, oh, fuck. I'm gonna shit an owl. And you can feel it move, like, it's trying to get out. I always wanted to fill my ass with confetti. So when I fired, I was like, what the fuck? Who was that magical man? Ladies.
Hey, fuck up!
I fart a lot after sex, and I think it's because my muscles won't do any more work. So I lay there and it's like, too late, you already fucked me, so don't fuck people so hard next time. I don't think farts are as gross as everybody else thinks. Everybody farts. There's like 8 noises in the human body. Women have 9 noises, but I don't want to talk about that last one. It scares me and confuses me. You know what I'm talking about? Like you're having sex and you hear, pfft. Did you just fart? No. Did I just fart? Oh my God, I'm farting, I don't even know it. We gotta go to the hospital. No, I queefed. Oh, I'm sorry, get out. Thanks, guys. Very nice to meet you. Thank you.
Stay tuned for more laughs on Access TV, live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City. Roderick Paulette is taking the stage when we return. Welcome back to the Access TV presentation of Gotham Comedy Live. More laughs happening right now.
And now, welcome to the stage, Rodney Paulette. Roderick Paulette from TV, making his TV debut tonight.
So let's start this way. I just got back from California. I was in L.A. Yeah, I like California. I just don't like Californians, right? You know, they're arrogant, right? I'm at a party. I'm talking to a lady, white lady. She found out I was from Ohio originally, and she freaked out. She's like, you're from Ohio? Oh, my God, Ohio. Oh, my God. Ohio. Oh, my God. Ohio. Oh, my God. Did you grow up on a farm or something? I'm like, man, when's the last time you saw a black dude on a farm? I'm without a chain on his foot, keeping his ass there. In fact, you ever see a black dude on a farm, you sneak up on him, tap him on the shoulder, let him know they're free. They can leave. It was cool, because I got to hang out with my buddy Rich. He's like my best friend. He's very excited. He just got married. He's excited because his wife is Asian. I mean, she ain't really Asian. She's Filipino, right? That's like the 5th tier on the Asian chart. That's the bottom of the Asian barrel. Let's get serious. No, let's be honest. Real Asian is Chinese. That's number one. Chinese, number one. Pow. Number two, you got your Japanese. Bam, right? Number three, you got your Koreans. Number four, it's a split. You know, your Vietnamese, your Laotians, your Thai. Then at the bottom, tier 5, Filipinos. I mean, how Asian are they? They speak fucking Spanish. Come on, seriously? Como esta is not Asian, you know? That's some Mexican shit. If you are Asian, don't be offended by my chart. I'm not, it sounds racial, but it's not racial. You know what I'm saying? I don't even rate the dudes. I just rate the women. This is how my Asian chart works. The higher up the Asian chart you go, the less likely you are to see that Asian woman with a black dude romantically, right? Like you see me with a Chinese girl, somebody's trying to get a green card. That's what's happening right there. Chinese girls just don't do that. I just moved. My new neighborhood, I guess you would call it gay? Gay? It's very gay, and I'm like the only black dude on an all-gay block, right? So every time I come outside, it's an event, right? My neighbor's like, oh my God, he's outside again. He is so brown. Mm. I like my gay neighbors. They're nice people. They're just weird. You know, they're always telling me how hard it is to be gay, right? Like my neighbor, he said this to me the other day. He goes, Rod, I don't know if you know this or not. There's still a lot of prejudice out there in America. If I know, hello. Dude, I'm on the first team, right? Me and Tonto, we're well aware of what the fuck happened in this. I've been black a long time, you know what I'm saying? I did not have to come out, you know what I mean? That'd have been weird, right? I'm sitting on the edge of my bed, I'm all upset going, I like ribs and rap music, I might be a black dude. I'm feeling kind of Wu-Tang-y, what do you think that means? My gay neighbors got me to march in the gay pride parade with them, which I'm glad I did, because I'm down for the cause. You know what I'm saying? You know what I mean? I think if you're gay, you should be proud. It's what you are, right? The main reason I did it is because black people, we don't have a parade, right? That's weird to me. Everybody's got a parade but us, right? The Italians have a parade, Irish have a parade, Puerto Ricans have a parade, gays have a parade. Yeah. So, you know, a little tip, white people. You see some black people in your streets, that's probably a riot. Go back in the house. We don't get the parade, we get the month. You know, that's our thing, the Black History Month. I'll be honest with you, folks, I never liked that too much growing up as a kid. I mean, I went to a predominantly white school, right? I was the only black kid in my class. I don't know why you bother celebrating Black History Month when there's only one black person in the class. It's just fucking weird, right? Because my teacher's like, okay, Rod, we're going to take the whole month and point out how different you are than all the other kids. And she would do it, too. She's like, African Americans, they have curly hair and broad noses. Everybody look at Rod. Rod, raise your hand. It's your month. They need to see you. Because here's a little tip. You're the only black kid in your class. It's Black History Month. Now you're personally responsible for 28 days with a show and tell, right? Like, day three, I'm running out of shit to bring in, right? I'm bringing in dashikis, afro pics, Shaft movies. My teacher's like, tomorrow Rod's going to bring in something else from Africa. Yeah, no, I'm not. How about something from fucking Cleveland? I've been to Cleveland. I ain't never been to Africa. I can only bring you shit from places I've been. I went to a school with 327 kids in it, 8 black kids in the whole school, right? I'm the only black kid in my class. You know how kids are. If you're different, kids tease you. That's what they do. I remember one time we took a school field trip here to New York City, right? And my classmates kept asking me, hey, Rod, take us up to Harlem. Show us around. You'll protect us, but yeah. No. I'm fucking 8. I don't know. I came on the same bus from Ohio. You idiots came. Here's a little tip, because apparently white people, you don't know this, but black people, we're scared of black people too sometimes. Just we are. Yeah. And if you're black and you're not laughing, you're fucking lying. You know exactly what I'm talking about. Whoo! Oh my God. Everybody black has had that moment. You know what I'm talking about? You walk in someplace like, oh shit. Where'd all these black people come from? No, get your purse. We're not staying here. This is, That's inside information for some of you. I don't know if you know this or not. You know, white people, you go someplace, you see a lot of black people, you get a little nervous. Black people, we go someplace, we see a lot of black people, we get nervous too, you know? That's why I live where I live with the white gay guys. I can't. I used to live in an all-black neighborhood. Not, sister, you live in a black neighborhood?
No.
He's like, no. I said, no. It's not for me. No, thank you. No, I'm full. No, thank you. No. I'm serious. White people, I know a lot of black comics give you a hard time, but I'm serious. You're excellent neighbors. You're excellent. You're awesome. You really are. Quite frankly, white people, you make a neighborhood safe. Yes, you do. Because you're fucking nosy. You will ask tons of questions. I like that. But a strange black guy come up to my door. My gay neighbors will come outside. Hello. Hi. I'm Steve. This is my boyfriend, Lance. Who are you exactly? I get home. I get the lowdown. That's nice. I don't want to stereotype. I don't want to give that impression that black people are not nosy and white people are nosy. That's bullshit. Black people, you know, we're nosy too. You're right here with me. Back me up. You know what I'm saying? Problem is, you live in an all-black neighborhood. You know, somebody could rob you, right? Pull up a moving van, you know, to your front door, take out all your shit one thing at a time. You know. Your black neighbors look out the window going, ooh, he getting robbed. They got his big screen. Woman in the back, should we call the police? Bitch, mind your own business. He got problems. We don't need that shit over here. I respect that about white guys. White guys, you're serious. I respect that. You see somebody fucking with cars, your neighborhood, middle of the night, you go outside, you don't care. Go right out your front door, nothing on but boxer shorts, black socks, sandals. Start yelling at people. Ever seen when they yell at people? That's the funniest shit, right? Hey, buddy, hey! The fuck are you doing? Yeah, you with that ski mask on holding that pistol. What the fuck are you doing? Your black neighbors look out the window. He about to get shot, baby. He about to get shot. That is not even his car. That's not his car. Just had a birthday, like last week, literally. Yeah. Oh, it's nice. Nice. I turned 48. Yeah. Look at her. Oh. It's nothing pleasant about this age. It's ridiculous. It's a stupid fucking age, is what it is. Young people, and here's the thing, all my friends are younger. They're all comics, they're all younger, they're in their 20s or 30s, and they always want to hook me up. Like, hey, Rod, we got to go out, this new place we're going to, man. It's hot, man. A lot of MILFs there, a lot of MILFs. I'm 48. I don't call them MILFs. Well, what do you call them, Rod? Fucking classmates, that's what I call them. I've been trying to explain to young guys what it's like to be 48. 48, let's put it this way. I am now at that age. If I have the choice between pussy or pizza, I'll probably take the pussy. But I want to hear about the pizza, too. I have ceased messing around with young girls. I'm done. If you're a young girl, don't bother talking to me. After the show, leave it alone. Stop. No. Too old for you. You know, get your life together. Don't fuck with me. Too old. Here's the problem with young girls, man. I'm at that age, man. You know what I'm saying? Something could happen to me during sex. You know what I'm saying? I could stop breathing and shit. Young girls, you know how you are. You're like, oh, that's cool. You're not breathing. I'll do that too. It's a little game. Ha! Bitch, call 911, please. Thanks a lot, folks. I appreciate it. I really do.
Stay tuned for more laughs on Access TV, live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City.
Jeff! What?
You got it.
Jeff Maurer. Okay. Where's Jeff Maurer? Erin Jackson! Scolaro! Roderick Paulette!